This is the Criterion Creeps podcast, and tonight we're talking about The Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie from 1972, directed by Louise Bunuel, and the synopsis from Letterboxd.com. In Louise Bunuel's deliciously satiric masterpiece, an upper-class sextet sits down to dinner but never eats, their attempts continually thwarted by a vaudevillian mixture of events both actual and imagined. So, as mentioned last week in the wrap-up of that episode, I had mentioned I'd seen this movie before. And way back when I saw this when I was in high school, I thought this was like the bee's knees of movies. I'd never seen anything like it before. And like I when you read about Louise Bunuel, he's like such a cool dude, making that enchant andalou. RJ, have you watched that before?
Andouille sausage?
No.
I don't think I've ever seen a Louis Bunuel movie.
So are you familiar with Enchant Andalou at all? The reputation? It's like a 1929 surrealist short film. It's got the legendary scene of like a razor blade cutting across like an eyeball.
How legendary is it?
It's pretty legendary. It's pretty influential short film.
I see that Salvador Dali was in it.
He was involved. It was like made during the heyday of the surrealist hanging out in Europe. He directed that L'Age d'Or and whatnot, worked on that. He's just one of those guys that like he trucked along, made a bunch of like early stuff, and then he kind of was in exile, hanging out in Mexico, making movies, just like scrapping together budgets to make movies. And then he kind of like had like a latter day, like rejuvenation of his career. Like when he was like old, like when he was like making Discreet Charm, like kind of like the late 60s and through the 70s, he was like back to like having a bit more of a budget, working with these famous European actors, doing that Bunuel thing. And everyone was super stoked to work with him. He's one of those guys that like early on when I was like getting into movies, it was like him and Buster Keaton were like two of my favorites. So like, I read this guy's autobiography, My Last Sigh. I was just like really into his stuff. And at the time it was like kind of slim pickings, actually being able to watch his stuff. Like at the public library, we had this on VHS. We had Belle du Jour, and that might have been about it. And then as years have gone on, I've managed to like kind of acquire more of his movies. And like a lot of Criterion's put a lot of them out. A lot of them are now like out of print, like this one. It's been out of print for a long, long time. I was looking and it was like people are trying to sell it for like way too much money. You're here in Canada where people like to really gouge you because you can't order stuff from Amazon from the States anymore, because that's great. This was a rewatch for me. I think like the last time I rewatched this, and this was like 10 odd years ago, I remember being like way less of a fan of it. Like it wasn't like when I first watched it, like I thought, oh, this is so cool. Like I've never seen anything like it. It really understands how dreams work. And like, it has this like odd flow, and it doesn't like, it's just kind of odd. It doesn't like really quite make sense. Like every other movie I'd seen up to that point, which is like movies in the theater in like the late 90s, you know, when you're watching like A Beautiful Mind, watching something like Discreet Charm is kind of like, whoa. But you know, now at this point I've watched far more movies. My palate has opened up quite a bit more as far as like cinema goes. And so it's always like something going back to like this particular type of 70s surrealist satirical movie. There was the one I watched like a couple weeks ago, Le Grand Buffet. This movie is like very similar to that. It's sort of like this dry, surrealist movie that doesn't quite make sense. And it's sort of this like attack on the bourgeois lifestyle and stuff like that. And I mean, obviously this movie is quite a bit like that as well. So I guess this is like my third time watching it, and I feel pretty similar to it from like the last time I watched it, where the movie's nowhere near as strong as like that first viewing, which I think was like also the context of like coming into it being like, whoa, I've never seen anything like it. And realized this is like a whole like subgenre of movies that existed before and after. Some like you could almost like say there's a linkage with this type of movie with something like Killing of a Sacred Deer in some ways, but like the film making is so different. like the way that this movie, like the way that Killing Sacred Deer is made now, it's actually very similar to how like a studio movie would be made, just like, but it's like art house inflection. Whereas Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie, you compare how that movie is made to like what was coming out in 1972, and it's like so different. So I think it's like, it's kind of hard to like watch this movie and like watch it like a regular movie, because I don't think that's his like intent at all. Like, he was making Bunuel movies. Like, you watch his movies, like we'll be watching Belle du Jour one day, That Obscure Object of My Desire, there's like Milky Way, stuff like that. A bunch of his movies are coming along, and I think it'll like click into more sense, like the type of movies that he is. But I mean, I don't know, this is the first one I think of his that I watched, and it worked for me that first time. This time though, there's like aspects of it that I'm like, I still really like a lot, but there's things about it that I'm like, that hasn't aged great. Because like, who knew what direction does? what direction do we know what movies are going to come? Some movies age incredibly well, like something like John Frankenheimer's Seconds. That movie like looks so modern, and like there's movies that you watch, you're like, Paths of Glory. That movie is like, that looks like it could have been shot yesterday and it would look the exact same. Like, and it's like, you never know what direction things are going to go. But I've got many notes about this, but I wrote a note to myself saying, I'm really curious to hear what RJ thinks about this movie. So, RJ.
What do you think I think of this movie?
I don't know.
What would you compare this movie to things that we have seen in the Criterion Collection so far?
Well, it depends on what you think of the movie. Like,
I'm going to compare it to two things.
Are you going to? Well, so there's like a Salo quality to the movie, like
not that
no but no, like I'd say like from the era, it's like, yeah, it's sure, it's Europe 70s, and I'd say that like from like a, like the look of the movie is far closer to Salo. It's like not sure, like as visual, like I think it's like Salo is actually a pretty like visually beautiful movie, like from a cinematography standpoint, whereas Discreet Charm is like kind of like very like this is just reality, it's just presenting like this world. I'd say that there's like also other elements of movies like Night Porter, where it's like, it's like 70s European stuff. And I think there's even like a bit of like, even kind of like, because of the approach to the non-narrative, a little bit of element of crime, which are like, which in like, well,
Night. So my bottom three movies in the first 100, my bottom three movies. Okay, I do understand what you're saying. The two movies that this reminded me of were Variety Lights and Life of Brian.
Mm-hmm.
Those were the two. And I don't know, do you remember what my opinion was of those two movies?
Well, Variety Lights, I think we were both pretty like indifferent toward. Like, that was like, I think that's like the weak, that's like, definitely the weakest Fellini movie.
Yes.
I mean, that was like his first movie and him figuring stuff out. And Life of Brian, I remember it was like kind of like a difference of opinion, because I think that movie is like a brilliant comedy. And
as
you
do
were,
many.
And you were just like, it's a grandpa movie, and it's like, it's grandpa comedy. But it's like, I don't know if I would like think of Life of Brian, but it passed my, it did cross my mind.
But you're a grandpa. Like,
but I'm what, 6 years older than you?
Okay, so here I'm going to hit you with it.
That's a weird grandpa.
I'm going to hit you with it. I know everyone loves Life of Brian. We talked about it on that episode. You can listen to it. I think this movie is more old man humor. And what I mean by that is, there's scenes where it's like, I got to tell, one character will be like, I got to tell you something really important. You got to listen to this, man. Here it is. And then he'll start talking, and then a plane will fly by, and it'll be like, and it'll just drown out the sound. And the other guy will go, Wait a minute. What were you saying? And they'd be like, all right, you got to listen this time.
This was on the phone.
Yeah, over the phone. And it was like that. And so, like, you don't hear it. It's like, okay, I get the joke. It's not landing for me. That's fine. And then, like, there's things. That's the kind of humor that I feel like is kind of old man humor. There were sometimes I thought it was really funny. Like, there's one scene when they're sitting down for dinner and the lady is like, everyone sit wherever you want. And she's like, you sit here and then you sit there. So she like tells them to sit wherever, but then tells them where to sit. Mm-hmm. I was like, that's kind of funny. I like that. So what was I talking? Okay. Yeah. So what, this movie, We popped this in the other day. I remember you said something like when you had first watched this, you thought this was a great movie. So I went in with an open mind. I was like, all right, I'll check this thing out. I watched it, and my initial reaction was, it's all right. It's okay. Like, it doesn't really land with me, but I don't hate it, which is a good thing. It's not like those three movies you mentioned that I really don't like. I didn't hate it. I just didn't think it was – it's not exactly what I like. There are certain parts that I thought were really good. Like, I think all the stuff with the priest is really good. Mm-hmm. Like, there's – when you introduce him, there's a scene where the lady – he's like, where's – he's like, that shed outside, is that the groundskeeper's shed? And the lady's like, yeah, it is. Okay, I got to go back to work. See you later. And then it zooms in on the priest's face, like super close. And I thought that was really funny. I was like, I like that. Cool. And then I like the way his story ends when he confronts the man of his past. I thought that was really cool. I was like, I like this priest story. So there are parts that I really liked. And then there were parts that I didn't like as much. I didn't love the counterterrorism with the Trumpian diplomat, like
Fernando Rey, the ambassador of Miranda.
And that's like a big part too of the movie. I was like, I can see this landing with a lot of people. Like a lot of people are like, that part's awesome. Like this guy's so like smarmy and is like, my country is this, my country is that. And the terrorism things are like flashy. And I get it. I wasn't like super into it. What else do I got here? I thought the dead people were cool when they do have those ghosts.
The ghost stuff, yeah. I kind of like forgot about that and like how it's really effective because of the way he presents it.
Yep. Yeah. So I thought that was really good. I was like, I like the ghost stories, things like that. However, I thought some of the dream sequences, it was like, this isn't – some of them were really good. I was like, that's exactly how dreams are like. And then some of them I was like, that's like a person – trying to think of how a dream would play out. There's that Inception like dream where it's like a dream within a dream, and the one where it's like the guys on the stage show, it's like, oh no, I forgot all my lines. I was like, that seems like a really cliched kind of old dream where it's like, I forgot my homework. I don't know, do people dream like that? Maybe. But so there was things like that I was like, maybe not. I thought those people were horn dogs like you. Mm-hmm. They were always trying to have sex everywhere. And I was like, that's crazy. They're also kind of assholes. Like that one guy brings in fucking poor fucking Maurice, the driver. And he's like, I'm going to do an experiment. Mm-hmm. Let's watch him drink this. And he like drinks it fast and then leaves. He's like, all right, thanks. And it's like, and then he like laughs about it. He's like, see, he didn't enjoy it at all. And it's like, well, yeah, because it was fucking awkward. It's like, you called this guy in who like works for you. It's like, here, drink this drink, man. If that was me, I would fucking plow that thing back and be like, all right, I'm going back. Going back to the car to wait. Like, yes. I would have done the same thing.
It's because you're a pleb.
I am a pleb, but most people are.
Yeah, exactly.
That's like that. So that diplomat guy, he's all about those alternative facts.
It's his buddy.
Like,
it's
like, no,
it's
no.
The it's the cuck buddy. He's the one who's like Mr. Snoot about drinking. Yeah. And they're all about like it's like thing they keep coming back to is like this is like this is about the bourgeoisie, these people that are like, I mean, yeah, it was a big thing.
I get it. It's just I'm just saying it didn't really charm me as much as other people do or other people might think. I thought the arresting party was kind of funny where it's like, I'm arresting you and I'm arresting you too. And then when they show that torture scene at the prison and they're going to like put a snare on that guy's dick, I was like, oh shit, that's crazy. But I don't know, man, like as a whole, there were parts that I liked. I was like, I can see why people like are really into this. But there was a lot of parts where I was like, eh, whatever. So I liked it. I don't think it's great. I'll probably never watch this again.
Mm-hmm.
Unless I get like watch more of this dudes and then I get really into it.
Which you never have in your life about any director at this point.
Not yet. only my few favorites. That I watch, but I don't even rewatch their stuff that often.
Exactly.
Yeah, so
I think we need to stop using that as a measure of anything. This idea of that like we're ever
you're
gonna have
watching.
that we're ever gonna find time in
Here,
our life again to like what rewatch a movie,
I'll
unless it's
rephrase
like,
that.
yeah.
I'll never think about this movie again. Whereas my favorite directors, I think about those movies all the time. I don't
Right.
need to watch them. Like, but there are scenes of certain movies that I love, and I think about that stuff like all the time.
Sure.
I'll
That
never think about this
that's well,
again.
yeah, so I mean that I mean
But
this
that's
is
not,
that's
I'm
like a
saying,
yeah, that's like a side thing because I mean there's like this
I
whole
get
idea
it.
that like yeah, the movies that like you're going to remember are the ones that like left you with an emotional response. And if a movie doesn't evoke an emotional response, then you're probably not going to remember it in a particular way. But I mean it's possible to have like an intellectual memory response like, or
That's
an
true.
emotional intellectual response where you're like, I really remember when I first thought about something and it was because of this, and you'll remember it strongly because of that. But like the stuff that like doesn't leave that emotional impression, it's probably just going to slide off your brain. And that's why Letterboxd exists, because it'll help you keep track of all the
Keep track.
movies you watch. And you'll be like, oh yeah, I did watch that. Like it's a good thing I recorded that because I would never remember it. And it brings me to like again like when I was editing that Twin Peaks episode the other week, I was like listening back to like our conversations from last summer, and there's things like I'm like I don't like now that I'm listening to it, I remember this conversation, but like never would I have thought of that conversation ever again. Like all of our conversations, like with family members, with siblings, friends, coworkers, you don't remember the conversations you have. That's why people's memories are specious at best, and like as far as like evidence of anything, it's kind of like, well. Do people really remember things very well? Most people's memories don't work that great. And you'll hear, like, I'll have a conversation with, like, a student and I'll tell them something and then I'll leave the room. I can still hear what they're saying. And then someone will ask them, oh, what were you talking about? And I'll hear them explaining something. I'll be like, that's completely not correct. Like, they completely got the wrong thing from what I was just saying. And that was like 5 minutes ago. And they just don't recall things. I'm like, fuck, that's like crazy. And I kind of like, what am I doing here? No one can have a conversation. So anyway, I'm like, yeah, I mean, unless like a movie you watch like completely like hits you in a way that like this is when it hit me to my core, like you're not gonna remember it. I mean, for me, like the first time I watched this movie, I remember it being like a big deal and like being like, wow. And then I'm watching it, like I've only watched the movie, like considering a movie like I highly regarded at one point. I've only watched it like, and it's a few other movies like too. Like when I first watched The Night Porter, I thought that movie was like amazing. And watching it again, I was kind of like, what
Gross.
was I thinking? Like that movie, like I've seen like way better versions of this type of movie. Like fuck, Phantom Thread is like a better version of like Night Porter. If you want to like get down to it, like of like a of a fucked up relationship, that movie's like way better made and like watchable. But I mean, it's also a comparing like a mode of like filmmaking. From a different era to like a modern movie, like older movies are going to have a much harder time. I was talking to a student today, and she's taking a cinema class, and they're watching movies like Citizen Kane and M and like all these movies. I'm like, oh yeah, I think I've heard of those movies before.
You're like, when are you
And
gonna watch
North
Salo?
North by Northwest, and talking with her, and she's like. Actually, I think she's around your age, but like she's not like a movie person really. And she was kind of like, meh, all these movies are kind of boring. And I'm like, what the fuck? These are like, they're boring. Why is Citizen Kane considered one of the greatest movies of all time? I don't care. And I'm like, oh, like I guess. But I mean, I've seen people like have that response on Letterboxd too, where they're kind of like, I don't know, I don't get it. And I'm like, well, it's influential, I guess. But yeah, I don't know, I don't really see anything. The story's not that good. And I'm like, what's a good story? So I mean, things are very subjective, and I mean, like, I'm in no way surprised that like Discreet Charm didn't work for you. I think there's like, as time goes on, I think it's gonna be harder to like maybe even get into that movie. I mean, in some ways, I was like kind of thinking about like how some people view like La Ventura, and they think it's this classic, and we both watched it for the first time, and we were like, whoo boy. Like I don't know how anyone could have like a strong reaction to it, and then some people get really mad and think we're dum-dums for not like loving the movie. But
Movie
like
stinks.
I wouldn't go that far. I would definitely say that it's like this is not an entertaining movie, and like I think these ideas could be communicated better. Whereas like I don't think that's an issue with this movie? Because I think, like,
yeah,
I think, like, it I sets agree. Out to do it. It's still a watchable movie. I mean, it's a breezy hour and 40 minutes. I mean, like, so I haven't even talked about my notes about this movie, which is like, just like watching it again, like that opening shot of the movie, it's like totally like a David Lynch opening shot, like of a car driving down a dark road and with headlights only, and it's just driving and driving, and I'm like, fuck, that's totally David Lynch. And it's like another noted surrealist. And yeah, so there's the movie's gimmick, which is rich people unable to sit down and eat. And you get like examples of things like, oh, there was a dinner scheduling snafu, and it's kind of presented in this way where like neither side wants to like admit they've made a mistake, and but they're so ridiculously polite in their denial, and they're like, oh well, I couldn't have possibly done it. Well, it doesn't make any sense. Oh well, we'll just go and do another thing. Indeed, you should come out with this. Well, I'm not dressed for that. Oh, come, just dress as you're dressed in your like nightgown. And then they go out and they go to like this inn, and there's like you're gonna start getting the suggestion of all the characters. Because like the one thing I will say about this movie is like you do get a sense of like all seven of the characters. Like they are all like fairly well written. Like considering you could have like hand waved it and been like, it doesn't matter who's who. In this though, it's like, no, they're like all like pretty defined. They all have like different jobs and roles. They're married to particular people. And they have these like occupations which drive, like, which actually do tie into the plot directly. Like, yeah, one of them's like a government official, but they're also like all criminals, and but they're above everything else, but they don't view themselves as anything that they're doing is like undermined, other than the fact that they're always afraid that the police are going to show up and raid them, and they're like willing to drop one another at a drop of a hat, even though they're all friends, and they're okay with that. It's acceptable behavior. And so like when they go to that inn at the beginning, it's like the why is the door locked? This is preposterous. And then they're invited in, they sit down. It's like, oh well, yeah, I mean, when a business is like this empty at this time of night, it's not a very good sign. Like, it's just like the snootiness of the bourgeoisie, of rich people. And we've encountered these types of people, I think, in our lives. But it's like a passing thing, because those people go back to their own little corners of the universe, and we go back to our ruts. And then at that point we get like the kind of like the ridiculous stuff, like terrorist plots, coke smuggling ambassadors, which like when you think back to like 1972, you have Fernando Rey, who's like the drug dealer, like smuggler in The French Connection. So same actor doing all this stuff like that, but the movie's like
whoops.
Yeah, so like just like, I mean, but the movie's like making fun of this stuff. It's like terrorist plots, and then like the idea of like these terrorist student cells, and talking about Mao, and there's like references to Vietnam, marijuana, free love revolution, Cold War ideology stuff. It's very much of the time of 1972. Like, it's very much plugged into that sort of like, these are the things that were interesting filmmakers. Like, fuck, if you watch those Jean-Luc Godard movies, holy crap, he just falls full on into it, whereas movies start becoming unwatchable because they're so invested in the politics. Whereas at least this, like, Bunuel is still making a movie. Like, it's still like, but it's just like an absurd, surreal movie of just like these characters and these scenes that he just sets up, and he's just like putting them together, and he's still following though the conventions of a movie where it's like the characters are defined, their motivations make sense, the performers are all like good, they act like actors in a movie, unlike potentially Element of Crime, which is like kind of a toxic movie. And that's like, again, that's another movie that I remember being like, yeah, I really liked that movie, and then watching it again, you suck. And I was like, ooh boy.
Yeah, that movie is so fucking bad.
Yeah, it's
let me tell you, buddy.
Yeah, that was a real disappointment. Anywho, so there's also this like underlining thing about the whole movie about like kind of like the complicity of like the church, like the guy, like the fact that the gardener priest, he's like, I want to help people out, I want to help the rich people. And it's like, wait, the rich people are like the last people who need any help. And they're like, oh, great. And then you get like this, the fact that they're like assholes who are like, oh, this guy's just coming into our house dressed as a gardener. What are you doing? Why are you letting this guy into the place? You got to be careful who you let in. And it turns out, oh, he's the priest. And they're like, oh, sorry. They changed their tune. And he's like, oh, no, that's fine. That's fine. That's fair. And it's like, oh, no, these are like, they're bad people. These are like not, these aren't people that need your help. I made a note here about strong cello politics. Where there's like the scene
that's kind of funny actually.
Yeah, where she's just like, I hate the cello. It's just a horrible instrument. Like, I need to change seats with you. I can't even look at it. And then like out of nowhere, we get like a Mario Bava style horror story where it's the story about this soldier. And again, but it's like, but you have to keep in mind that like all these like these three stories we get, they're from like soldiers and from police, and it's like they're all like. They're all different parts of like the state, the institutions or whatever. And they're all like, they're just like admitting these things to the bourgeoisie. It's like there's like a direct connection of like why they're saying these things. But there's these linkages of like poor people are like not in this movie, really. Yeah. Like when they are, they're like students with their toy dogs getting sniped off.
I was going to say, when you mentioned like the military people, that stuff was totally lost on me. I was like, I don't care. Like, I thought the dream sequence was cool that he was talking about, but like there's that dinner with like the military people. I was like, I don't care about this.
But that so that's later on. So that first story though is like really neat. Like the editing, the editing of that. So talking about good directing and like editing and pacing. That's really great. Not like a Del Toro movie. And then there's like, that was at the drinkless cafe where they keep making orders to like for tea, and they're out in coffee, and they're out, and then they're we're out of water. I can't believe it. We have like absolutely nothing, and there's like all these people still sitting around. I thought that was cute. And then there's like the scene where you get the affair that's being carried on by Fernando Rey and Buddy's wife, and he's like. Oh, and he shows up and he's like, "Is that my wife in your bedroom?" He's like, "Yeah," and how odd.
Weird. What are you guys doing?
What's going on? All right, we'll go down to the car. We have some things to finish talking about. Okay, see you down there. And I just wrote in all caps, "Cuck."
Beta cuck. Huh?
And so the main character of the movie is like Fernando Rey, the ambassador of Miranda, the fictional South American country. And when he like confronts the one female terrorist girl, he gets himself a handful of stuff, grabbing her tits and her ass, and saying, "You got a body for love, not war."
Real Jarrett style, hey?
Yeah. And there's like a bit where he like empties out her bag, and he's just like, you got this, you got this, you got the key to dreams, and he just continues on. You're like, the key to dream, what? And it's just like, it's just there. I love that. That's just like, and then that's like kind of like from that point forward, you do get the thing, the setup of like everyone waking up from their dream, which is always like, I don't know, in this, it's like, it works for me. Because it's just like it's funny because you're like oh I just had this dream and they keep
waking. Just had the weirdest dream
there's just like this ongoing thing of these men giving anecdotes about like and they're like ghost stories and whatnot, so I'm not sure what to make sense of that other than it was just like he had this idea for it and just went with it.
That's what I mean, like there are things, it's like I said, like I don't dislike this movie, like there are parts that I really like, I just don't think they were all like soup. They didn't all land for me, but it's like I was saying, I can see why a lot of other people might be really into this fucking thing. It's I get it. I just, whatever.
Yeah.
It's not totally my jam. That's all.
It's not a draw for you.
Yeah. There's no Mel Gibson. There's no hot dudes. There's hardly any abs in this movie.
Yeah. It's not like American Sniper at all.
It's not like American Sniper or Back to the Future at all.
Not at all.
Doesn't have any of that stuff.
None of that. There's like the one where I think it's when they sit down at the dinner that's like a theater, the actual stage, where it's got that bouncing chicken. Like there's like these chickens that are just taking on the thing and they're just bouncing all over the place. That reminded me of Racerhead because there's like that weird chicken in there too. So it's more David Lynch sort of like dream things about chickens and driving down roads.
Chickens. And quinoa.
Yeah.
And dirty bearded men.
Mm-hmm. And then there's deadly dinner parties.
Yes.
Yeah. You know,
we've all been there.
We've all been at those.
Yeah.
And then dreams. Note here. And shotgun death coming from our good friend, the priest, who forgives the man who murdered his family. And then he just comes over, grabs that shotgun, and just blows that guy away. And there's these like surprising moments of like violence of people's like heads just blowing up.
So, I mean, I really liked the priest story. I was like, well, fuck, you just wasted that, dude. Nope. I didn't see that one coming. No.
Then we finally do get an actual police raid. And then we get some piano torture. And that's all a dream, of course. Mm-hmm. And here's my note. I am really interested to hear what RJ thinks of this.
Was it after the piano torture? Because that's when they tried to put the snare on that guy's dick. They mm-hmm. tried to get him in the dick snare.
Yeah.
I thought that was nice.
Yeah. I don't know where you picked those ones up, those dick snares.
I can make it for you.
Oh, see, I always hate when I do this. There's this great quote about, he's a true gentleman, which I think is like...
You don't remember the context
I can't
anymore.
Remember the context of it, but I remember being that, like, that's like, it was like a defense of a guy being, oh, he's a true gentleman. I think it's like the ambassador again.
After he slaps him?
Yeah. And just like, I love how everyone's always like saying, well, I've heard in your country that like it's a really violent place and all these horrible things are happening. He's like, yeah. No, that's, he's like, fake news.
It's alternative facts, Jarrett.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then like right at that home stretch, they do get to eat some soup.
Yeah. And then in his dreams, the diplomat guy gets a lot of lamb.
Yeah.
He's sneaking that lamb under the table.
Yeah. Lamb or ham. Couldn't really tell. I think it was supposed to be lamb.
Yeah, it was called leg of lamb, but it did look like a little bit of ham. One piece was roast beef for sure.
It was definitely am of some sort.
Ham. Mm.
So dreams.
Yeah, Inception, man. That's what this movie was based on, right?
Or
Inception was based on.
Yeah,
it.
Totally.
Dreams within dreams.
Yeah, totally ripped this movie off.
Yeah. No, it's... I think this movie's all right. It's, I don't know. Whatever.
it's above whatever. Are you saying it's above your pay grade?
No. No.
And by no, you mean yes.
No. I think this movie's fine. It's whatever. I don't care that much about it.
Well, RJ, there's some people who've got some hate for this movie. Like yeah, Hannah, I'm sure. Like Hannah Kay. Half a star. Meh. I don't know. I can't muster up the will to care about this movie. It's not bizarre enough to be interesting from a surrealist perspective. It's mostly just long, dull stretches of rich people doing nothing and going to dinner parties and not going to dinner parties. Experimental films are always going to be tough to sell me on, as I'm first and foremost a lover of narrative. But even beyond my personal biases, it's a movie that I can't imagine anyone loving. It's not visually exciting or thematically powerful. Maybe it's politically significant. I would love to sit down with someone who actually likes this movie and find out why, because I can't find anything particularly good in it. It just sits there. Oh, except for the scene where the priest gives the dying guy last rites. That's actually a really interesting scene before we go back to yawning at our protagonists.
What was this lady's name?
Hannah Kay.
Because I feel like she had a lot of the same opinions I did.
But she also gave this half a star, which I guess
I don't think that's...
That's like the absolute awfulest of scores you could give to something. So this, like, to me, as we were talking about last week, when people give ratings this low, I'm like, they're kids, I think. Like, they feel like they're like... 18 years old or something like that, watching movies, and there's like, I hate this movie. Kind of the way when I say, I think Guillermo del Toro is a bad director. It's like, I think he's like not like a he's not the worst director. I'm just saying, I don't think he's as good at his job as he should be. Ergo, he's bad at his job. Ryan Siemens gives film one star. Perhaps this was my fault, but I was under the big impression that this was going to be a very surreal and symbolic film. Instead,
symbolic for what?
Instead, I was bored to sleep, literally. Once I understood what the film was saying within the first 20 minutes, I checked out and just waited for the film to be done. It seemed like there was no process, barely any substance, and I despised every minute of it. I can see what this film was trying to do on paper, but it does not translate on screen, and the execution botches it.
Okay, like, all right, so a lot of these people, it's like some of the things that I was saying, but, like, I don't think it landed with me either. It's like, yeah, I get what it means on paper, sure, but I don't think it's a bad movie.
Yeah.
I just didn't like it, that's all.
Mm-hmm.
It's not bad, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Luke... 1.5 star. hands down one of the biggest disappointments I've had from a film in a long time.
Because they were looking so forward to it.
The Exterminating Angel is one of my all-time favorite films, but this is just a catastrophe, ceaseless in its dream sequence bullshit, and these people are awful. You can show me that these people are awful and titled shit stains without wasting my time and blowing all your energy on putting them in different scenarios where they continue to do nothing but be obnoxious, oblivious, and drawl. I get that that's the point, but he pulled off 10 times better in one room with a larger cast in The Exterminating Angel. Every time I thought this movie was turning around, it shit in my face and had a good old laugh about it. I'm beyond mad.
Why is he so mad? Why is he so disappointed? Who gives a shit?
I don't know.
Like, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, who cares?
That's why I read these things, because I'm just
yeah,
like...
I know you do, but I hate it. I hate you. Who cares about all this? All these people are so like, oh man, this sucks. This stinks. I hate this. Like, who fucking cares? Get over yourself, nerd.
Yeah, I think that's all words we could live by.
Mm-hmm.
No.
So anyways.
So what does the discreet charm of the bourgeoisie mean, RJ? It
means sneaking some of that ham under the table.
You're damn right. And you know what the image is going to be for this episode.
Sneaking that ham under the table?
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
It's money.
Nice.
Well, I think that's it. I still like this movie, but yeah, I mean, it's not like a movie would be like, dog, you gotta watch it. Like, it's like,
come on, dog.
Yeah, brah, what you mad at, brah?
Yeah,
come at me, brah.
It's fine. Some people will love this fucking thing.
Yeah,
some people will just be like, I don't care.
Yeah, I mean, I like the Simon of the Desert from Bunuel. I'd say people should watch that. I think that movie is like super good. And I watched that not that long ago either, and it was like, I love that movie. Anyway, after the break, RJ's going to be sneaking that ham, and ooh, I'll be in the bedroom with his lady.
Eating that meat?